1010 WOLB Baltimore and WERQ-FM HD3 Baltimore.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
We are back every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore and beyond. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. Some of the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, create or update your will or your deed, or to purchase your ground rent, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation, but you're not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or comment to 667-334-7242. And last but not least, if you missed a broadcast, please check us out on YouTube. All you have to do is type in the Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up where you can listen to it on your phone, your computer, or your television, and you can share it with others.
All righty. And I call him the Dean. Our other co-host, Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. Good morning, Baltimore. Good morning, Baltimore. And that's the last good thing I'm going to say today. 410-547-8820.
Uh-oh. He must be ran for mayor today. Yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. That's 410-669-1738, specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangements, seminars, veteran benefits. Veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. If you don't have any insurance, now, listen, we start a new year. If you don't have any insurance, get some, and you might want to preview or review what you do have because you might need to get some more. Okay? All right. Before we get started, we do have a special guest. Several things. We were not on the air last week because of the weather. It's the first time in about 15 years that the Frank Conaway, because it's never really happened, really, during that time when we would go on the air. But during that week, we must give our condolences and out to the family of one of the hosts of their own radio show here on this very fine network. And we're talking about the late Patrick Henderson. Patrick was on these airways for many years. In fact, we've had him when Frank was alive. We had Patrick on as a guest. And he used to call in regularly sometime as, and get involved with what we're talking about. But what you may not have known about Patrick was the fact that Patrick was an icon and a legend in gospel music. At one time, Patrick was the minister of music of probably one of the largest churches in the Church of God in Christ chain. And I'm talking about West Angeles Church of God in Christ in Los Angeles. He was the minister of music there. And many people look at him as the innovator of praise and worship music in the church. He's going to be sorely missed. I only heard that he passed in Texas. I have not heard about any arrangements. Maybe somebody might know. I don't know. They may have had the services already. I don't know. But he's going to be sorely missed. He was a good friend, and we just want to put that out there. We also lost during this past week or so one of the last of the great female jazz singers, black jazz singers, and I'm talking about the late Marlena Shaw, who passed away. Marlena was quite an artist. She was a little behind people like Sarah Vaughan and Ella Fitzgerald and Nancy Wilson and Carmen McRae, and that she came along a little later, but truly she made a mark in the music of jazz singing. So just wanted to bring that up. Okay, we got a lot to talk about today, but we do have a special guest, and I'm now going to turn it over to our co-host, attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, to introduce that individual. Now, if you want to call in, the number to call in is 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010, if you may have any questions for what our guests have to say, or if there's something else that you might be on your mind, because these lines get tied up pretty quickly. But I'll let you know when it's open. Well, you can call in now if you want, but Tehma, go ahead.
Good morning, Baltimore. In our News You Can Use or Information for Dissemination segment, we have with us today Mr. Wallace Beal. Mr. Beal is a native of Baltimore, Maryland, and a proud graduate of the Paul Laurence Dunbar High School. Additionally, Mr. Beal earned a Bachelor of Science degree in Industrial Technology and a Master's of Science degree in General Administration from the University of Maryland College Park. Mr. Beal's work experience has been both in the for-profit and nonprofit arena of the as an industrial engineer, quality assurance manager, marketing manager, and workforce developer. From 2012 to 2020, he was employed by Goodwill Industries of the Chesapeake as a program manager, which afforded him the privilege of cultivating career opportunities for countless residents in the city of Baltimore and surrounding counties in the construction, building trades, healthcare fields, and IT workforce. In 2020, Mr. Beal took a leap of faith and founded Legacy Crossroads Foundation, LLC, a full-service consulting firm for the recruitment, training, mentoring, and retention of construction, building, trade apprentices. Mr. Beal has assisted with the placement of over 100 men and women into construction apprentice programs, such as plumbers, electricians, sheet metal workers, carpenters, iron workers, and installation mechanics. Mr. Beal, how are you doing today?
Good morning, everyone. I'm doing fine.
Thank you for joining us. Anytime on this show, we have an opportunity to bring opportunities to our listeners or to people our listeners may know in the form of workforce development, something that they can build a career off and earn more money for their life and their family. We try to do so. Can you tell us a little bit about your programming, your apprenticeship programming, and the opportunities that are available?
Gladly. I presently recruit for the Baltimore, D.C. Metro Building Trades. We have what we call Raising the Bar. It's a three-week pre-apprenticeship program where we prepare candidates to get into the building trade. There are roughly 16 different trades in the state of Maryland. we put them in a situation where they can apply. We've been very fortunate. 95% of the people that complete the program get into 4 or 5 year apprenticeships. During the 3 weeks, we give them 40 hours of math because the days are gone in construction when all you need is a pick and shovel. Math is highly required. Make sure that they're OSHA certified. We make sure that they're CPR certified. We set up tours and interviews with each of them to the different apprenticeship opportunities. And at the end of the 3 weeks, as long as they can do the work, they can go to work. Most of the apprenticeship programs are 4 to 5 years. You work full time, and then you go to school in the evening. They'll start you at about $20 an hour with a raise a year. The ultimate goal is for you to sit at the end of the apprenticeship for the state exam to be a journeyman. And at that time, your hourly wage for 40 hours ought to be between $40 and $42 an hour. Men or women, we have no age limit. You got to be at least 18, and you got to be able to perform the work. You need to be a high school graduate or GED. You got to be able to pass a drug test, and you need a valid driver's license. Because right now, the majority of the work is not in downtown Baltimore. You'll have to travel at least 30 minutes to get to the work opportunity. We run this program twice a year. I'm finishing up the recruitment for our class. It starts in March. Our next class will, I'll start recruit at the end of April. We normally put 16 to 20 individuals into the program. We have like a 99% graduation rate. We are truly blessed. We're looking for men and women of all ages. You can have a background that really won't prevent you from getting into an apprenticeship. It just limits sometimes where you can work depending upon what your background is. But I'm truly blessed to have the opportunity to run this program. We've been doing the program. I started at Goodwill in 2015, but we've been doing it now for 8 or 9 years. And we continually look and recruit. I go to high schools. I go to colleges. I go to neighborhoods. I go to Rotary clubs, barbershops, wherever the talent is. Because people say people don't want to do construction work. That's not really true. What I tell people, this is not Home Depot construction. 90% of the time you're going to be outside. You're not going to be building houses. You're going to be building schools and other buildings.
And once again, can you go over the trades that are offered?
Okay. Carpentry, bricklayers, electricians, laborers, painters, plumbers, steam fitters, HVAC, operator engineers, sheet metal workers, cement workers, iron workers, and insulator workers. And underneath each of those are different trades. In the state of Maryland, there are 25 different building trades. I just quoted about 10 or 12.
And if someone gives you a call today, when does the next session start?
The next session, I will, if they give me a call today, I will email them a flyer. The next session will start roughly about May. The process is we start with a Zoom to see who's interested. We run 3 Zooms. We allow 40 people in each Zoom. They get a chance to ask questions. And if they're interested, then we schedule them for a math assessment. And after the math assessment, we schedule them for a drug test and interview. After that, we select 16 or 20 people. They go through the 3-week class. During the 3 weeks, we give you a $100 stipend, which basically covers your gas for the week. Our next class will be held down on Wilkins Avenue, down the street from the hospital. If they're interested for the future, and I can be reached at 443-226-7826. And my email is wallacebealjr@yahoo.com.
And what are some of the barriers that you've faced in recruitment?
We have three major barriers that we, just because you have a high school diploma today, does not mean that you're prepared academically. We find people that have weaknesses in three-digit addition, multiplication, subtraction. They struggle with fractions, addition, subtraction, and the ability to measure. The other barrier we find is drugs. We require a drug test because all of the employers are going to drug test you. Unfortunately, about a third of the people that we recruit struggle passing the drug test. Other than that, they have to understand that this is a career. It's a 4 or 5 year commitment. It's not a job. It's not something you're going to try out. It must be something that you want to do, because the ultimate goal for us is for you to get licensed, and then you have a choice. You can continue to work for the union and make, I don't know, 40, 50 bucks an hour, or you can start your own company and pay yourself $50, $60 an hour.
And one of your slogans is, or one of the points that you want mainly emphasize, is that people must be competitive.
Yes. In today's environment, you have to be ready. You have to be flexible. You have to want it. You have to understand what's expected of you in the work environment and be able to do it. Nobody's going to give you anything. You know, if you're making $20, $30, $40 an hour, people expect you to show up on time, which is 15 minutes early. They expect you to be trainable, and they expect you to understand that it takes time to become an expert in the trade. But if you can do that, then you're competitive. Because once you become a journeyman, you can take that license to any state in North America and work and start at whatever your top grade is as a minimum. We have people that have gotten their license in Maryland that are working in Tennessee, Ohio, Texas, and California.
Bob, you got any questions?
Not right this second.
Mr. Bill, Carlton,
yes,
Douglas,
sir.
Here. First of all, thank you for coming on the show. It's great that you're coming on, because folk are always hollering about jobs, jobs, jobs. And Frank used to say that was his key issue, jobs, jobs, jobs.
And complaining about minimum wage.
Yeah.
So this is an opportunity,
this is an opportunity
to make money.
Some money. But I guess my question to you, when I was coming up, these jobs that you have just talked about were pretty much covered during that time. What happened that now you're looking for people to get trained and to fill in these jobs? What happened in the last, I guess, maybe 50 years or so that this has happened?
It's really happened the last 20, 25 years.
Okay.
A lot of people in these jobs are ready to retire. They've been out there working, and now they're in their 50s and 60s, they're ready to retire. And two, diversity is required more than it's ever been. I have to be honest to you. Back in the day, 20, 30 years ago, these opportunities were made aware through three methods, and I called it FBI. Either your father told you about it, your brother told you about it, or your in-law told you about it. When I started this journey, I said, I got to break FBI. because everybody wants to make a good wage for their family, have health care. Our biggest issue is that a lot of the vocational education programs that used to exist, I'm 75. When I went to Dunbar, we had strong vocational programs at Carlton, at Mergenthal. Mm-hmm. Well, those programs are not there today. They're mostly classics. So when I went to the union 8 years ago and said, there's talent in the Baltimore area that want to do this work. Their first response to me was, the people don't want to get their hands dirty. My response was, who'd you talk to? And then they said, they don't want to do the work. Who'd you talk to? Well, then my first class, I visited different schools, different neighborhoods, found a talent. And since then, we have graduation 5 years. I've gone to 3 graduations of people who are talented. They need replacement talent. And at the same time, a big driver is now this infrastructure program. Money has hit. Well, the construction industry is behind the curve. It takes 4 or 5 years to get someone prepared, and they need talent now. And what we're trying to prevent people from doing is going to New Jersey and bringing the talent to Baltimore. Don't go to Virginia and have the people work in Baltimore. Have the people in the Baltimore, D.C. area perform the work so the work will stay in the state, right? Because for them to say that the people don't want to do the work, that's a myth. To say that women can't do the work is a myth. We found it not true.
Let me ask you a question. Most of the work that you're referring to is public works. It's public works, and the companies that do that have to compete for it. And typically, the company that gets the work is the one that's supposedly submitted the lowest bid. In Baltimore City, the only requirement that there is for hiring local people is for new hires. There's nothing in the current living wage law or local law that relates to relates to how the current workforce is situated. So my question is, how do you persuade the companies that win the contracts, in many cases out of state, and you mentioned New Jersey, one of them from New Jersey, of course, is Spinello, a name that I'm sure you're familiar with, Metra, I'm sure you're familiar with that name. How do you convince those companies that win the contract based on low bid to do something with respect to hiring that that the law doesn't require?
I am not involved in that part as of yet.
Okay.
I know that they are working to get the contractors. I know under this Biden program, there are going to be specific requirements that people live in specific parts of the state, and they should be the first that they should be involved in. The specific details, I can't comment on right now.
Okay, and just so that you know, there is one local contractor, R.E. Harrington and Sons, that has established a foundation, and the Harrington Foundation, in fact, provides training to young people who desire to get into the business of underground utility construction. Harrington is one of the is one of the larger underground utility companies. In fact, it's the only black-owned utility company. In this area. And they've created a foundation. They offer training, and they've tried to establish a relationship with Baltimore City Schools to establish a pipeline between the schools and their training program and so forth. So if you give me a call out, if you don't know about it, I'll put you in touch with Bob Harrington. And it seems like you all are working toward the same ends.
Which brings me to
something, and then I'm going to
Pardon?
One of the issues is there's a myth out there that says everybody in Baltimore City needs to go to college.
Yeah.
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 Mm-hmm. I agree. Mr. Bill, Bob just said something that I kind of want to piggyback on, and that's about the vocational education in this city. You and I are around the same age.
Okay.
So, you know, I'm a product of Edmondson High School, 67.
Okay. I'm a product of Dunbar, 6. I understand.
Okay. I remember well when Carver and Mervo, well, first of all, I remember Carver was predominantly black and Mervo was predominantly white for vocations. Oh. And, of course, over the years, Mervo integrated. But what happened, what do you think happened, or what can be done, or has there been an attempt to get to someone in the Baltimore City public school system and say, hey, listen, you need to bring back hands-on teaching in these vocational schools so that you can be, we can be pumping out more people who can do these specific jobs. Well, has this been attempted? As far as you know, I'm not saying you yourself, or but has this been attempted, or have they refused to listen?
How can I say this tactfully? It's not that they have refused. Is that up till now they've made it tough. I have been in different schools doing job fairs or whatever, and what they do with me, they set me back in a corner beside the gentleman that's recruiting for the military. It's about money. The school system makes their money based on how many people they prepare to go to college. It's not how many graduate, but how many who go. It's not about anything. There's limited access. As I, you know, as you said, I remember that when Mervo used to, part of the graduation for their seniors were, they would build a house out on that, was near the football field, assemble it, a trailer would come in, and then they would sell that house, take those funds back to support the program. I remember when Carver used to have their graduates would intern for Baltimore Gas and Electric and other organizations as seniors. I don't know what happened, but there's been an emphasis that says everybody has to go to college and vocational education is not important. And I tell people all the time, do you fix your toilet? You know, tell me, do you fix your toilet? Do you fix your air conditioner? No. Do you lay the brick in front of your yard? No. Right?
And so, if you got an electrical problem, who's going to do that?
I tried it once. Knocked me across the room.
You were lucky because it took you out.
But until there's got to be a coming of the minds, and that's a meeting that I'm having next week with the Baltimore D.C. Metro. There's got to be coming a meeting of the minds with the unions and non-unions, Annapolis, and the school system, and accept the fact that it's great to have STEM, okay? It's great to have all these academies. But when you took the title out of a school, Mervo is no longer Mervo Vocational, Carver is no longer vocational, you've taken that out as your effort, and there's a hole that's missing, and no one's trying to fill it. The biggest problem that I have is that people think that if you work construction, you're not bright. That is built for dummies. And as I tell people all the time, if you look at a plumber's paycheck, okay, and if you look at somebody else's paycheck, the dollars are going to be bigger. okay, for his 40 hours. And plus, you get major health care, right? There's so many people out there today that are working, young people, that don't even have health care because they think they're going to live forever. They don't think they're ever going to get sick. You can make a very, very good wage for yourself. Yeah. And see, here's the other thing. When you and I were young, you could go to work at Sparrow's Point and raise a family. You could go to work at the automotive industry and raise a family. You could go to Western Electric, but many of those industries are no longer here. When I was young, the Baltimore, D.C. area was a manufacturing hub. You had Procter & Gamble downtown. You had Allied Chemical. It doesn't exist anymore here. We are a service industry. So therefore, we don't think that we need to fix anything.
You mentioned Maryland and D.C., so once someone enters the apprenticeship program, do they have the option of working in Maryland or D.C., or how does that work?
Yep, absolutely. I have people that have gone through our program when they graduated. D.C. comes to them and said, look, we have this opportunity. And they work. I have students. I follow. Once you get accepted into whatever the trades you're in, I follow you for a minimum of a year. Either a text, a phone call, an email. How you doing? Tehma, what's going on? Because what I have found is that getting the opportunity is one thing. Keeping the opportunity is another. And as I tell my students, everybody can't take this journey with you. Everybody don't want you to take this journey. Because you're the one that's got to get up 5 o'clock in the morning and drive 40 minutes, right? You're the one that's worked hard. You can't party during the week like you used to. Everybody can't take it with you.
Mr. Bill, we got a couple people on the line. I'm going to see if they have a question for you. Tehma, you got anything to come through the...
No, we don't have anything on a text message, I just want to co-sign on your saying that the messaging is what keeps a lot of people out of the trades, because a lot of people think that the trades is like a secondary option. You know, I don't go to college, I can just do a trade. No, if you're smart enough to go to college, you have to be smart to do a trade as well. Mm-hmm. You know, if you can't read and you can't do math and you can't get into college, unfortunately, you know, a trade may not be your thing, because you're going to have to be able to read and you're going to have to be able to do math.
And not only that, now I'll say this, you know, even when I was in school, and I also graduated in 66, but I'm not from Baltimore, but when I was in school, even in the so-called academic track, you had to take courses outside. I had to take home economics. I had to take shop. I had to take agriculture. It didn't matter where you were going. There were certain skills, unless you had to be exposed to life skills to go forward. But what's happened is we've allowed the whole education system to become an industry in and of itself, and it pushes kids, not only pushes kids who don't necessarily need to go or want to go or have be equipped to go, but they pushes kids in that direction, and you come out of school not only without a job, but with a debt that is going to take you to your age 50 or 55 to pay for.
Okay, Mr. Bill, if you, I'm going to come to these callers. In this order, Jason, Carlos, Tyrone, Gene, and we have someone calling. And we got a full board here because we have another special person we need to get to, too. Now, if I come to you and you don't have a question for Mr. Bill, then I'll put you on hold and we'll get back to you on whatever you want to talk about. So we're going to start off with Jason. You got a question for Mr. Bill?
No, sir. I'm calling about Patrick's funeral.
All right. Okay. Let me put you on hold here. Bro, Carlos, you got a question?
No. Great work. I'll hold on, please.
Okay. Hold on. Tyrone, you got a question?
No, I hold up. I just want to speak as a member of a union that's a labor union, and a business owner now, and also I have a college degree.
Okay.
And, right. But I'll wait. He's putting out the information.
Okay.
I want to talk about how hard you are taking the people right now.
All right. Yeah, Jason called back. He got cut off by mistake. Let's go to Gene. Gene, you got a question for Mr. Bill?
Yeah, I sure do. I worked about 8 years for a major bank here in Baltimore in human resources, and I had a lot of non-exempt people, and especially a lot of tellers, right? And so what I saw was that they couldn't do the math, the arithmetic. And so my question to the person that, you know, your guest, is are you having a problem finding people that, like I did, and just in recruiting basically high school graduates who couldn't do what you were supposed to learn in the fourth grade and the fifth grade? Because most of the tellers, bottom line, is adding, subtraction, division, and multiplication in order to settle, right, the settlement process. And so that's not what's happening in the school right now. They are not able to teach, for whatever reason, these children how to do adding, subtraction, division, and multiplication. You could become a manager in a bank if you can do decimals and percentages, right? So I could ask anybody who calls in on the show today,
Okay, let them have the answer the question now. Go ahead.
Let me tell you. Part of the program, we do 40 hours of math, okay? Because, yes, what we found is exactly what you have there. That's why we give the national assessment, the TABE. That lets us know where you are. And then I have two teachers that work for me that we will take you from fifth grade math, addition, subtraction, multiplication, up to Algebra 1. We give homework every day. We check it every day because we know that the basics are lacking in some cases. You know, they have a problem telling time. You know, you ask someone what's quarter after the hour, they're lost because they've been taught to do digital. They have a problem counting money, okay? So we don't try to embarrass anybody, but we like to know where you are. And then we work in 3 weeks. We bring you up to that, and then we give you the national exam again. And we've been very fortunate that we will move you a minimum of 2 grades. You know, I've had educators asking how you do it. I said, because I don't have time for BS. Class starts at 8 o'clock to 4. If you're 5 minutes late, you're late. I don't have time, right? You got to show up on time. You got to do the homework, right? I don't care about the dog dying. I don't care about who did. You have to be able to show through the involvement in the class and the test that you're learning. Our expectations is to prepare everyone to be able to sit and take any of the tests that are given by any of the unions.
Okay, let's go.
I understand what you're talking about by tellers, but, sir, that is just representative of the talent that is out there today.
Okay, let's go to Brown. You got a question for Mr.
Yeah, you know this Brown from Sandtown.
My man.
With the Masonry Apprenticeship Training Program registered with the state of Maryland. 5 years. Now, I've been hearing some information coming across these airwaves this morning. Carver and Mercantile is still in action. Masonry and carpentry. The students do not have the patience to learn the trade when you speak with the teacher. And I am a teacher because I do teach my apprentices for 4 to 5 years how to lay brick. Now, here's my question. They resident you for 3 weeks. It's impossible for them to learn anything about hands-on. You're teaching a building trade from a book. You cannot do that. The state of Maryland requires the theory and the hands-on at the same time.
Sir, that's not what we do.
I understand that because you as a middleman, meaning yes. that you find the students. I deal directly from the state of Maryland guidelines, so there's no middleman. So I get to see the paperwork, I get to see the hours, I get to see the way that the requirements that the state wants me to teach them. You do not see that. And keep in mind, to every apprentice, the state law is you need 5 journeymen around 1 apprentice. It's against the law to fill any project with a bunch of apprentices without the amount of journeymen in between them. So if you think that you're going to go out and hire a bunch of apprentices to do a building, that's not going to work. Now, wait a minute. Let me share this with you.
Let him respond.
Because you came in with a dissertation instead of the question.
Right, now you don't want the man to respond.
That is not what our program could do. Our program, I said that we generate a pathway where we connect with a specific union that if you're going to be a bricklayer, the bricklayers come, interview, select people for their apprenticeship program. It is a 5-year program, hands-on, and they go to class. This program does not train anybody to be an apprentice. We are just preparing you, presenting an opportunity. I recognize that you got to have hours, hands-on, because when you sit for the state exam, you have to have your hours. You have to have proof that you can do it. I understand that's not what we do. We're just putting people in a situation where you could go to a union and apply for an apprenticeship, fill out the paperwork, take the test. 4 or 5 months later, you may find out you're accepted or not. What our program does is, the unions have come to us because we have given them great candidates, and they say, we got 3 slots for apprentice for carpenters. We got 2 slots for plumbers. We got 3 slots for electricians. At the end of our 3 weeks, they interview for those positions, and away they go. I am not sitting here and saying that I'm going to give you hands-on training.
That's exactly. And I understand that, because I understand that you're working from a middleman perspective.
Okay.
This is why it's very important that people like myself and R.E. Harrington and other contractors that serve in the state of Maryland and abroad register your company with your own apprenticeship training program with the state of Maryland, so you can have full control of your apprentices and teach your apprentice the way that they should be taught. Now, I can take somebody with no experience, ground zero, in 6 months, I will have you ready for the work site.
All right, Brown. Give your number where people can reach you, because we got to go on.
Listen, 443-622-7989. And once I register you with the state of Maryland, I don't care what state you move in, your apprenticeship rating does not go down.
Give it again, Brown. One more time.
443-622-7989. I can use 15 bricklayers right now. Journey.
Okay. So y'all ain't got no reason for not being unemployed. you can get trained. Let's go to Mark. Mark, you're on air. You got a question for Mr. Bill?
I do, and I'm glad you got to the phone number part. That's what we need. We need working together, Thank you for getting to that part. But anyway, brother, you were saying something, because I was a teacher's aide, and then when I was working in the school system, guys, we worked with small groups of young people that was having hard time.
Hey, Mark, we're under a time constraint here. Get to the question,
okay,
please.
So my question is, you said when you was in the school, in the classroom, you were like basically sitting in there and all that kind of stuff. So why do you think that they didn't have you guys, you know, hands on with little groups of students helping them do whatever?
Because, as I said earlier, that is not their goal. That's my opinion only. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That's my opinion only. I just think that they want their goal is to get people accepted into colleges, not for jobs.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Well, Mr. Bill, we certainly want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to come on the Frank Abercrombie Esquire. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
We want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to come on our show. Before you go, would you give a telephone number where people can reach you? Concerning getting to work, because I'm getting sick and tired of folk hollering about I can't find a job. Well, hey, the man saying you need to get trained, and the jobs are there. So
yes,
go ahead, Mr. Bill, and give your number where people can reach you to find more.
My name is Wallace Beal, B-E-A-L. I can be reached at 443-226-7826. And my email is wallacebealjr@yahoo.com. And if somebody will send me an email, I will send them a copy of the flyer that we use so they can get some idea of what's expected. Not a problem.
Thank you, sir. And much success to you.
Thank you very much. I need all of it.
Yeah.
A lot of people. Opportunity.
Okay. Thank you.
All right.
We're going to go to, because we have another special guest on the air, but I'm going to take these callers real quick. Please get your point in very quickly, please, because we do have to go on. Let's go to Jason first. Go ahead, Jason.
Good morning, family. So, of course, with heavy hearts, I'm actually on my way to Dulles Airport to catch the flight to Dallas. Patrick's homegoing is tomorrow. I heard you mention it. Being late to the ancestors tomorrow. So, I just kind of thank the family because the community actually got together because I couldn't afford it. And thank you, Linda Batts, and thank you, Radio One, the family of Radio One, because they gave me some travel money as well to be a part of this homegoing. And I'm just not going representing myself, and my friend. But I'm actually going to represent the city of Baltimore, who is in mourning at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, please give my condolences to the family. I've been knowing Patrick a long time. We had a very mutual friend that I went to junior high school with by the name of Kenny Moore, who wound up becoming the music director for Tina Turner when he passed away. But Kenny started out here in Baltimore as minister of music of several churches here, the last being the Great Jones Tabernacle Baptist. So I've been knowing Patrick a long time, and he's going to be sorely
missed. And he actually did some work with Kenny. So
yeah.
They actually did some work together. So he has a history of a lot of folks that he's worked with. So
yeah. Be safe, man.
Thank you for the time.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I don't fly, so I don't fly.
That's why I say be real safe. Let's go to Brother Carlos, you're on air.
Yeah, I have a question for the attorneys, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
But on the first guest that you have, I just want to mention that self-motivation, this is Brother Carlos saying, that self-motivation is a major, major component of people applying themselves. That's my opinion. On the this is my question for the attorneys, and this has to do with the 14th Amendment that we're discussing a couple weeks ago, and about the Insurrection Clause. And I'm trying to square the circle. If Roe v. Wade was dismantled and sent back to the states and deemed a state prerogative, the 10th Amendment delegates the election process to the states and deems that a state prerogative as in terms of application and procedures and so forth. Now, how can the Supreme Court determine that Roe v. Wade, which is a state prerogative, is not the same as the election process, which falls under the 10th Amendment? And I'm just curious as to what your take is on that.
I think the Supreme Court determines what is going to be state and what's going to be federal. Because at one point, Roe v. Wade was a federal law. It was the law of the land.
Right.
Then the Supreme Court determined, okay, we'll send it to the states. Currently, the insurrection is a federal law. That's the constitution law of the land. It's federal. Now, the Supreme Court could say, if they decided to, well, we'll leave it up to each state to determine whether or not insurrection is a, you know, whether or not this act is a violation or an insurrection. They could pass it to each state to determine individually, but that's not where it is now. Right now, it's federal. It's according to the Constitution, and so that's why the Supreme Court has the jurisdiction to make that decision, and they haven't decided whether they're going to keep it federal or whether they will allocate it to each state.
And to put it another way, when they overturned Roe v. Wade, what they simply said was, you don't have a constitutional right to an abortion. And with respect to the insurrection, it involves citizenship, which is protected under the Constitution, specifically even the 14th Amendment, which assures equal protection to all citizens. So there's no question but that citizenship and equal protection is a constitutional right that's written in the Constitution, whereas that you won't find the right to abortion anywhere in the Constitution. It was expanded to that under the theory of right of privacy. And this Supreme Court simply said that there is no such federal right under the Constitution. That's why it's back in the hands of the states.
Okay. Last call, because we're getting ready to go into the second hour. Tyrone, quickly.
Okay. First of all, before I start, I would like to say that 74%, according to the U.S. Census, 2027, 74% of Americans consider themselves as white, including Nikki Haley. Okay? 58% consider themselves as non-Hispanic white. Right. Now, last time I called about that, y'all said I was putting out misinformation. Let's get that straight. I don't put out misinformation. The way I send information is a little confusing to some people because they never heard that way before. So let's just slow down when we start accusing people without checking. All right? That's very easy to Google. All right. Now, that being said, okay.
I don't know what you said.
I don't either.
Okay.
But we got somebody waiting for a half hour now. All right.
Yeah. What I said was, a couple weeks ago, I called in and I said 74% of Americans consider themselves as white, according to the 2020 census. Very easy to Google. And 58.1% consider themselves as non-white Hispanic. And y'all immediately said I was putting out misinformation. Now, I took offense at that because you did that without even checking. Very easy to check. Okay, now, that being said,
I don't remember that at all.
Me either.
Yeah, I remember it because I was quite a...
Well, I'm glad you do. Yeah. So let's go on.
Okay, so I don't put out misinformation. Let's get that straight. Okay, so that being said, I'm a steam fitter, okay? I did a five-year apprenticeship. I learned how to weld. I learned how to do computer-assisted drafting. I learned how to do work on boilers and all this kind of stuff. It took me 5 years to learn how to do that. Steam fitters are making $42 an hour now, okay? Now, because I'm a master plumber, I'm a licensed master plumber, I'm a licensed master gas fitter, I'm a licensed master HVAC tech, certified welder, I have my own business. Okay, so obviously I'm making more than what I was making, what we'd be making at $42 an hour. So
These jobs are not to sneeze at. Problem being for black people, and a lot of us don't understand, and that's the point I was trying to get to the politician you had on, is that sometimes our criminal records will slow us down. And when I was in there, we actually had to get some of the black people that we got in, we had to get them a pardon from the governor.
Okay.
And
thank you for the information. Yeah, we got to go on. We're going to the second hour. Okay. Bob, when we come back, we have a young lady. You want to introduce her now?
I will set it up now. We hear a lot about entrepreneurship and encouraging people, particularly black people in Baltimore, to engage in entrepreneurship. Unfortunately, Baltimore City has one of the worst records around for not paying its vendors. When we come back, we're going to hear from a young lady, African American woman, who owns a company here, and she's going to tell you a little bit about the saga that she's been involved with in trying to get paid for the work that she's done for Baltimore City.
Okay. All right. Okay. Don't touch that dial. We're going to come back and we're going to talk to the young lady that Bob has asked to call in. And we're going to talk about a whole lot of other things that's going on right here locally and nationally and internationally. So don't touch that dial. This is every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB, the Frankie M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob Dashiell, yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. We have some lines open if you want to call in, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. And if some of you city workers out there are listening and you know about the fact of some of these bills not being paid, you can call in too. Talk to you. Don't go nowhere. We'll be right back.
His father works some days for 14 hours.
Talking the day, soul at night. On the new 1010 WOLB.
For decades, we made progress to reduce cigarette smoking, but Big Tobacco has a plan to increase progress.